Namaskar to everyone. Welcome to this evening of entertainment. Sorry, this evening of interaction with Mumbai. So let's start. Question answer. If you have any questions, so start with question one, and then we can proceed.
Okay.
Greetings to everybody. I can see some people. I saw many before. Okay. Start.
Sir Ambal, pranams, and thank you for giving us this opportunity.
Not at all. Most welcome.
The first question is from Mr. Amol Bhavsar Thane.
Ah.
Sir, he is asking, it is mentioned in your autobiography that Sri Maheshwaranath Babaji helped you to activate certain regions of your brain, due to which channels to higher dimensions were opened. Sri Maheshwaranath Babaji referred to it as a real meaning of dvija.
What?
A real meaning of dvija.
Dvija. Yeah.
So can you explain dvija to us, and is it required for each human being for liberation? That is his question.
First of all, dvija means born again. There are born again Christians also, born again baptized, which means that someone's life is opening up to the spiritual realm. So that one is not merely on the material plane. We have to be on the material plane. You eat, drink, you sleep, you work, fine. But something more than that, when you are entering into a spiritual life, and you are born into it, that doesn't mean you already become perfect. All the people who took Gayatri were called dvijas. Among all the people who took Gayatri, how many have attained moksha? So dvija does not mean moksha. Okay? It means that you are entering into a new spiritual birth, apart from your physical birth. Dvi janma, second dvija. Now, Maheshwaranath Babaji did not put anything in my head. He agreed to an experiment somebody else wanted to commit, wanted to perform. Because he felt that I needed a kind of boost to go forward. That boost was required. If I had chosen to remain quietly in the Himalayas, roam around and meditate, no boost would have been required. Maheshwaranath Babaji foresaw that I was going to meet all kinds of Homo sapiens. And to handle the peculiar Homo sapiens from all states, including Maharashtra, it needed some kind of a boost. Otherwise, I would have gone mad. So therefore, he did something to make me more capable of working on that. Dvija, or being born again into the spiritual life, was done much before that. Because the moment he initiated me and I started my journey, already dvija is over. That thing which I have described in Kedarnath, of that masked Jain monk types coming, now I am wondering if that COVID, that is a different section altogether. It was meant to boost my capacities to be able to handle. Now you see, because of that, many people ask me, how do you know this, how do you know that? People following any spiritual path or discipline, if they have questions, I am able to tackle it. If I were not supposed to teach or go out into the world, remaining quietly in the mind, all that was not required. Also, it made it easier for me to zoom out of my body, not this zoom, so that sometimes, you know, I can act as a spiritual spy, see if somebody is just lying or actually meditating and so on. So that, I don't do always, don't worry. We have a private rule, don't read private letters. Yeah, but in some cases it is required. I have a very close man who has been working it for more than 25 years. He says he has stopped drinking, but he is drinking in his house. So, how do I know? Even his wife doesn't. So, sometimes required to correct people. Mm-hmm. So, that's what it is. It's nothing to do with dvija. That particular incident. No.
Thank you, sir. So, before I go to the second question, I would like to say it is with Mumbai, we have Pune and rest of Maharashtra also.
I know. Sorry. I knew that. I saw Pune. I saw different. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The second question is from Dr. Arundhati Malviya.
Mm-hmm.
She's asking, many say, always live in the present moment. At the same time, it is also said that one should have hope in every situation. But sir, hope is always related to the future. So does living in present moment excludes hope? This is her question,
sir. So some part of the answer is already in the question. She said, many say, live in the present. Right. Many say, but many cannot live in the present. Already her question is in a way where you can find out what the answer is. Many say, many don't live in the present or cannot live in the present. Therefore, since many cannot live in the present, they can live only with hope. If I live in the present, then there is no need of hope because I am not aiming at anything. The moment I say hope, which means I want to do something and I am hoping that it will be okay. I want to get up tomorrow morning and have a bright sunshine. I am hoping it could be a bright sunshine. It would be a bright sunshine. So when that is not there, that element is not there, then such a person is living in the present. So while many say, few can practice it. As long as you cannot live in the present and practice, it's better to have hope. Because if you're living in the present, there is no meaning of hope at all. Nothing to hope for. What do you hope for? You see every instant, everything as a wonderful experience. So you don't wish for something. You know what I mean? Yeah, if your shirt becomes old, you might wish for a new shirt. That's simple. But not anything in the psychological sense of the term. I hope I made myself clear.
Yes. So the third question is from Abhishek Kapoor. He's asking, what is the exact significance and place of prana in the context of Prakriti and Purusha? Is it a part of Prakriti and does it carry an identity during the life?
I don't know where he got this complicated question from. But let me put it this way. Since prana is not Purusha, it can not be other than Prakriti. In Purusha, there is no need of prana, there is nothing. It's beyond all that. Prana is life energy. So life energy is also part of Prakriti. The link is that in this world that we live in, which is ruled by Prakriti, or rather run on the principles of Prakriti, the principle which is closest to taking the mind to a quiet state where it can recognize the Purusha. Once it recognizes the Purusha, then the mind actually has no more function from the point of view of Kaivalya. No other function. Now, the nearest principle through which you may be able to kind of approach or go close to the state which will reflect the Purusha is the breath, is the prana. So, when all attention is taken away from the outside indriyas, and attention is given into the prana, then this prana then becomes a link to that which is beyond, which is Purusha. But prana per se is part of Prakriti. It's not beyond Prakriti. But it's kind of a subtle link between Prakriti and Purusha. We have no other bridge other than prana. So prana is the bridge that connects you to the Purusha. It is not Purusha. It's not part of Purusha. It's part of Prakriti. Now look at this. Also, prana is not the breath. The breath is shwasa. Now, shwasa is intimately linked to the prana. Prana is the ultimate life energy that operates. Even what we call the energy of the kundalini, in one school of thought, is called mukhya prana. Although the Madhvaites also call Madhvacharya mukhya prana. So, it's the most important of the pranas. So, prana is divided into udana, samana and so on, depending on the functions that it performs. That is prana. Shwasa is our breath. And shwasa is very closely linked to prana. So, if you are able to be aware and be able to control and manipulate your breath, then you will be able to work with prana also. That is the link. So, shwasa, prana, both in Prakriti, but connecting like a bridge towards Purusha. This is the general picture.
So, at the end, he is also asking, does it carry an identity during the life? Or?
Yeah. Or?
Or in one of your lectures, sir, you have said that prana is everywhere. It is not only shwasa, it is beyond shwasa. If I remember correctly, you are saying it is in every cell.
Yeah. So
if you can elaborate on that.
Yeah. So as long as the prana is connected to the shwasa in your body, which happens even when one is in the womb, it starts, then it has its identity temporarily. Once the body goes and all the koshas are finished, then it has no identity. It goes back to the universal prana, which is there in every cell, in the plant, in the animal, even in the maggot. But as long as you're alive and you have a personality, the prana acquires a temporary identity. It's not permanent.
Thank you, sir. I'm moving to another question. This is from Sanjay Bobade. He's right now in Pune, but you know, you call him Karim Rajak.
I know.
So his question is, if he's doing something good for the society, for the common cause, when he's doing it with selfless motive,
okay,
what are obstacles and hindrances which he has to face?
Okay.
In such cases, he feels down and, you know, frustrated. In such cases, how we have to handle the situation and motivate it?
Right. If you are doing good to others, in whichever way possible, you don't look for success or failure. Don't worry about that. You say, I'm trying to do the best that I possibly can, and go ahead with it. If the operation has, it cannot entirely fail. There may be some success, there may be some failures. Ignore the failures and apply yourself to it completely so that again you continue with the work. You don't stop it because there are obstacles. That is the secret of karma yoga. When you say karma yoga, normally we all do karma. But when karma should be converted into yoga, in that case, you should keep working, not even wondering whether it's going to work or not work. If you apply your mind to it, it will generally work. If it does not, in some instances, then don't get worried about it. Move forward. Don't say, now I'm frustrated. Move forward. Nobody on this earth has done everything successfully. Understand that. The very idea that everything that I aim, even if it's for the good of others, or even for my own good, is going to work. We are living in a world of illusions. It may or it may not work, but that shouldn't make us go away from doing it. If you persist, it will work. If it doesn't work, even at the end, because of the persistence, you will attain moksha, which is the greatest possible, better than any other work.
Sir, next question is from Seema Bendre. This always happens to all of us.
Yeah.
She has put it in nice words.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, why does it so happen that there are a lot of questions when we are going through our daily grind? And we need to ask you. But when we are with you and we have to ask, there is absolutely nothing we remember or feel important. We are just happy to be in your presence. Now, sir, how do we carry this in our daily life? She wants to with your presence.
You cannot carry it in your daily life. The reason why many questions don't spring up when you see me is because I have no questions. Okay, my mind has no such questions. It's all done, settled, finished, all over. So when you sit with me, perhaps, because you and I are same, we come from the same material, from the same source. Outwardly we may be different, but we are the same. So perhaps when you sit with me, that sameness reflects on you, and then therefore, so what to ask now? What? There is nothing to ask, you know. But you don't have to carry it with you. What you should do is to find out the reason why it happens. The reason is very simple. If you touch your true essence, which is yourself, after going through all the questions, answers, you know, nobody can find a state where there are no questions or no. It happens. You have answered one, another springs up. You answer a third and the fourth springs up. This whole cycle of question answer ends only when there are no questions. What questions to ask when I understand that I am alone, there is nothing? What do I ask? Nothing. So, instead of trying to carry me or my image or my, which is good as a practice, but in essence, you'll be free of your questions and all that permanently only when you understand the fact that that which is in me, seeing me, the reaction in you is there are no questions. That essence is also in you, and that we should go towards that. When you understand that you are Chidananda Rupa, Shivoham, Shivoham, What can you ask? I mean, what is there to ask? There's nothing to ask. That's your true essence. So go towards that. Don't attempt to carry me all the time. Well, it's a good practice. In the beginning, I also had the problem. Please, believe me. I didn't suddenly drop from heaven free. I had a problem. I used to feel that I should always be with Babaji. Then there are no questions. Everything is clear. Babaji said, try to figure out why I am free so that you also get free. So you don't have to have me to be free. You know what I am trying to say? So understand that. If you look at me as a physical being, but also understanding that in true essence, I am not what I appear to be. And if you understand that that is what you are also in true essence, problem is solved. It takes time, of course, because we always have separate identities. And I'm not saying that you should say, I am you. It's not easy to say, I am you. It's easy to say, but it's not easy to experience. But it's a good start. Or you can ask a simple common sense question. If he is free, why cannot I be free? I am also a homo sapien. Is he special? Am I not special? Keep asking these questions. So one day you are free. No need any Zoom, nothing. Ask Kashmira, she knows. She's looking at me from the right side. Next, move.
Vishesh Gokhale from Thane is asking, it is said that we have a baggage of karma from past lives and keep adding to it. How can we reduce this baggage? Is there any indicator that we know that the baggage is reduced? Do we have to go through many lifetimes to square off this baggage?
Well, I did. I went through many lives. Read the journey continues to shed the baggage one by one. Till in this life, I kind of threw it away. So it happens. But then, you can't say which stage you are in right now because you don't know your past life. Maybe you are on the verge of throwing away everything. Who knows? It's only after it's thrown away then you realize all that back. So forget about your past lives and all that. In this life, see how you can stay in this world unaffected by the burdens that you carry. That's the starting point. If you can work on that, then you'll soon be free of the baggage. And in each individual, it may be different, the baggage. Remember that. Because what baggage I carry may be different from the baggage you carry. So, in your life, you watch carefully, one day you'll see that there are some traits in me which are not part of this life. Something is there. Then you realize this is a baggage which I'm carrying. Then you decide, I have to step out of this. Partly this is what the psychiatrist will also tell you. But they speak from a psychiatric point of view. I don't go to psychiatrists because I don't need to. Because I know of two psychiatrists who met each other and shook hands. And one said to the other, you look fine, how am I? So since I know how I am, I don't go. So, next.
This question is from J.D. Benkale. She's asking, how to handle difficult or rather hurtful parents to succeed in spiritual life? Is the concept of karmic debt real? Here I feel my son must have called her. I don't know.
Karmic debt is real because we may be repaying some debts from our past in this situation. True. However, I'm not sure if this young lady is really very clear and accurate about her parents suppressing her and so on. Because sometimes it's a psychological feeling which needs a counselor. If she goes and attends to a counselor, a good counselor for some time, she'll get rid of the feeling that the parents are persecuting her. Maybe they actually are. In which case, if they actually are, then we have to find ways and practical means of how to handle this. There's no way in running away. If you're independent, you can run away and stay away and carry on with your life. But if you're not, you can't. So you have to be dependent on them. And also don't put all the blame on your parents. Some blame may be in us. So be ready to admit our mistakes. After all, they're your father and mother, right? So forgive them even if they commit something like that and move forward. They have the people who have brought you out into this world. So forgive, forget, and move forward. That's the only way. I know there are some very materialistic parents who are very worried if the child becomes spiritual. Yes, that's also there. Then it has to be handled in a different way. But I think maybe one sometimes misunderstands the parent. There is a generation gap. There are various factors. So don't get too resentful. Carry on with life. Forgive and forget. And don't let go of your spiritual aspiration, whatever happens.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Mr. Muthu Kumar. He's asking, sir, for intelligent people and spiritually aware person who's on spiritual path, many times they get into depression.
Why?
They've seen that some intelligent people also, and some people who are walking on a spiritual path also, get depressed or get into depression.
Do they? Okay.
Questioner must have observed, sir.
Okay.
Then he's asking, can our spiritual practices prevent ailments like this?
Spiritual practices prevent?
Even ailments like depression.
No. Spiritual practices are not meant to cure depression. In fact, if you are suffering from bipolar disorders or a depression, it's better not to meditate, because that will deepen it. Because what happens is, already they are introvert, so when they meditate, they become more introvert, so it becomes worse. So for them, it's good to have bhajan, kirtan, go for walks, have good food, do exercise. It's not going to help. Yeah. However, if the depression is because of your life and your daily problems and so on, then meditation is a help. But I would say that you should always check up with a proper expert to see, are you really like everybody else and kindly everybody is depressed at some point or the other? Or are you suffering from some malady like bipolar? In this case, meditation is not a cure. You need to take the proper medication and look after yourself. Okay, but if it is depression, like I'm depressed, I can't move forward in my spiritual life, my worldly things are not working, I'm not unbalanced, but I'm depressed. In such cases, meditation is a great help. Now, the greatest help is to realize that in true essence, you are not this body, but it's something infinite. When you begin to understand this, then there is no space for depression. What you get or what you don't get doesn't matter, because you are in true essence, all-pervading, full of joy and understanding, purna, complete. When the mind goes to understanding that, then it frees itself from all kinds of minor depressions. Even spiritual people who are fully involved go through states which may be called depressive. But you should make sure that it's not clinical depression. These are two things. Even Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was quite depressed, and he wanted to commit suicide. But that is not because he was unbalanced, but because he couldn't achieve his goal. And he said, what is the use of living? So these are two things: clinical depression and being depressed for not moving forward in your spiritual path. These two things are two different things. So you have to distinguish between them. And if your depression is due to not attaining spiritual heights, then meditation, chanting, help from a teacher, all these help. But if your aim is not spiritual and you are depressed, meditation is no cure for that.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Sanjay Kavale. He's asking, if the thought is considered as reaction of the past,
okay,
how to observe the thought and our reactions impartially without indulging in it?
By indulging in it?
Without indulging in it.
But all thoughts are not reactions of the past. No. You can say the present is a continuation of the past, not reaction. Reaction is a wrong word to use. All thoughts, sometimes yes, but all thoughts are not reactions to the past. Present thoughts are a continuation of the past. And future thoughts, thoughts about the future are merely constructions based on your past experiences going through the present. So you actually don't know about the past because it is gone. It does not exist anymore. You don't know about the future because it is speculation based on the past and the present. The only thing you know is the present. But nothing else you actually know. Now this present, of course, I understand, I agree that it is a result of the past. I agree. So if you see that clearly and say that this is coming from the past, but it is not useful to me, so I need to get rid of it, then try and stay in the present instead of all the time going back to the past. Understand this factor that past is only a memory for us. It does not exist otherwise. Except as a continuation of your biological cells from the past to the present. Beyond that, it does not exist. So, the more you try to look at yourself as you are now in the present, the more can you get rid of the reactions of the past. Future, you don't have to worry. Because you don't know. You know only the present. So work on that. Actually, that is the crux of the karmic theory. Because you cannot go back and tinker anything. Where will you go back and tinker? There is nothing there. It doesn't exist for us now. You can only tinker with the present. Future you can't tinker because you don't know what it is. Where can you work then? In the present. So the crux of the karmic theory is how to handle the present and see that you don't go, that you actually free yourself from the conditionings of the mind. This is the most important thing. When you're freeing yourself from the conditioning of the mind, sometimes your past impressions come and you see it clearly, but you move forward. Remove it like a screen and move forward. So let's not worry too much about the reactions to the past. Let's worry about the present and see how you can handle it. The truth cannot be in the past anyway. Then it becomes a memory. Memory is not reality. It's in the past. So the truth has to be now. What is the truth right now? You are sitting before me and I am sitting. That is the only truth. All others are speculations. At the moment. It will relapse back, but it's... Okay.
Okay, sir. Varsha Ghiwala is asking, Param Gurudev, through reading, intellectually we know I am that. How do we move ahead to realize I am that? What practices and discipline will take us to realize that?
Yes, she's right. Many people, see, we read, I am that, I am that. You were repeating, I am that, nobody reaches anywhere. Even if you wear a cowpin and sit down and say, I am that, you will not reach anywhere. Because I am this. I am reminded of an incident. Once in my lifetime, I met... That book that was written, no? Oh, I am that. Who is Nisargadatta Maharaj. Okay. So, we were sitting there. There were other people. He was smoking a cigarette and sitting there. And I said that I have read that book written by... I didn't say written by. I said, I am that. So, he said, koi angrej ne likha. But I said, but Tattvamasi is like, I am that. He said, main o hoon, ye hai na, o hoon, I am that. He said, main to wo nahi hoon, main to ye hoon. I don't know if you got the significance of what he was trying to say. Simply by saying, I am this. So, while there are practices to calm the mind so that an undistracted mind can understand this fact, there are no actual techniques for finding out I am that. Because I am. I don't have to prove it in any way. There is nothing. So the constant understanding, not repeating, constant understanding that perhaps I am different from what I think I am and what other people think I am, constantly reflected in the mind can lead to the understanding of I am. Not that I am that, but that I am. That is a very uncertain word. You don't know what that is all about, right? I am. When I understood what I am, then I know what it is. So, constantly thinking about it. All the practices that we do are meant to bring about a certain concentration of energy because it's usually dissipated. You require a sharp, one-pointed attention to get to that I am. But always we are distracted. Pranayama, Kriya, everything is done so that the energies are not dissipated and you have full energy to look into this question. When that happens, then only it can be understood, not by a distracted mind. One time it says, I am somebody. Then next minute it says, I am somebody else. We have so many identities, right? Even though we have a name and a form, we have many identities. The office, I am different. In my house, I am different. With my children, I am different. So there are so many identities, right? So as long as the mind is caught up in these identities, it cannot see the truth. What I actually am. That happens when the mind is silent. So, any practice which helps you to keep your mind silent will also help you to understand this. But not by chanting, I am that. That doesn't work. It's by looking within. What am I right now? Look, unless I know where I stand, suppose I'm in this room. I want to be free. I have heard people saying I'm that, but I don't know. I want to be free. I'm in this room. Now, I have to explore this room completely to figure out where the door is, from where I can get out. Instead of exploring that, if I sit here and keep saying, I am that, which is outside the door, I am that, does it work? First, I have to know myself properly as I am, not as Brahman or Supreme or Atman or anything, as I am. When I know myself as I am, then I'll find out how to get out of this image of mine and be free. So, constant observation of your mind in action is very important. Not while sitting down only, but also in action. What am I doing? How am I doing? What is the reason I am doing? Then it becomes a constant meditation. Basically, what is the motive for my actions? Now, that is also difficult that people prefer to sit down and say, I am that. You will go nowhere. You can go on saying, I am that, but I am not that. Like Nisargadatta Maharaj said, I am this. So, find out, I am this. Before you know, I am that. You know, I hope I am trying to convey in the best way possible. Okay.
So, one more question. This is from Jitesh Gautam. He is asking, again it is related to an earlier question, what hope does common man like me have to get moksha? How to understand that we are fertile seeds on the path of spirituality?
If you are actually believing what you said now in the question, you are very fertile. It's those who think they are uncommon men that don't succeed usually. We are all common men or women. To even have the humility to say that I am common, I don't know, and how do I reach, is a good start. Make sure that you don't get swelled up by the pride of knowing this, knowing that. even though you need to read and understand sometimes to move forward, but not get swelled up by that pride. Remain a common person always. If that is possible, then there is a great chance of becoming uncommon. The moment I become uncommon, very little chance of becoming the reality, to touching the reality. Look, I have also read many things and all that. Then I see some people who have read more than me, some who haven't read anything. Those who haven't read anything at all, are they in any case, any way, inferior to me? No. In fact, sometimes it is good not to read anything at all. There are cases of great souls who have understood the truth basically because they didn't read anything. But you can't say that to an intellectual. He wants to read, to understand. Good, that's okay. But all I'm trying to say is, when you say I'm a common man, please understand I'm also a common man. So if I reach, you reach. That humility is essential to move forward. Even now, I don't think I'm special. Really, seriously, I'm not trying to make a show of it. I don't think. I think I am myself. That's all. So that's a good, simple start. Really, what happens? I know a lot of slokas, so I'm special. No. There are hundreds of people in this world who know many slokas. They're not special. Special means what? The mind is no more centered. It's spread out. And it's always constantly in its true essence, which is joy. I'm not saying you should not learn. But if that learning does not take you to the truth, then it is still not a very useful knowledge. That's what I'm saying. It may be necessary to survive in this world. I agree, fully. But it may not help you to touch that which we are seeking. If you're not seeking, you wouldn't be here listening to me, right? I am convinced that you are seeking, no doubt. And if one person touches it, I will be the happiest person on earth. My job is done. Then I will say, Arati, you take care of, I am going. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
We have 15 minutes more.
Yes.
Or 20.
If you want to have to give any message to the team of Maharashtra.
In Maharashtra, the special thing about Maharashtra, there have been great many spiritual people living in that area. Not only the Nath Sampradaya, but also the Varkari Sampradaya, the Dattatreya Sampradaya. Jnaneshwar himself was a Nathpanti. Dattatreya is very well known. Shirdi Sai Baba decided to go and settle down in Maharashtra. So it's a place where so many great... Akalkotkar Maharaj lived there. So it's a place where there is a lot of a spiritual element, even in the air. We have many wonderful things in the spiritual essence in this land. Of course, I always feel jealous sometimes that you appropriated the name for your state as Maharashtra. It should have been given to India. Anyway, it doesn't matter. You got it. You've taken it. I'm happy with it. Therefore, behave like a proper Maharathi, which means this mind that sits on the chariot where this the sense organs are the horses and the inner self sitting down in the heart center and controlling the one who is holding the reins. So consider this, and while you are busy with your activities, after all it's the commercial hub of this country, don't forget the roots of the spiritual seeds that have been sown for hundreds of years in this part of the land, and keep your mind constantly on that. Carry on with your work. That's my advice to all Maharashtra.
So we should mention, in this COVID period, though we were locked down, we were able to have our monthly satsangs.
Very good.
So we continued that.
Very good. I'm glad. I heard that you are having regular satsangs.
Yes.
Okay then. All the best. God bless. Nice session. Okay.
Pranam, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Pranam.
Thank you, sir.